CHBJ 0105印度大乘佛教思想的特色。吴汝居，中华佛学研究所研究员。http://www.chips.edu.tw/chapter/html/chbj/0105.htm 中华佛学学报第零一期 P123-135 民国76年台北中华佛学研究所 http://www.chips.edu.tw Chung Hua Buddhist Journal No 01-1987 Taipei The Chung Hua Institute of Buddhist Studies ISSN 1017-7132 印度大乘佛教思想的特色。吴汝居，中华佛学研究所研究员。P123 提要。本文旨在检讨现代学者的说法和就有关经论自身的说法来看印度大乘佛教思想的特色。作者以为此种特色为不舍世间，此种对世界的态度贯通一切大乘经论，有以大乘经为然而表现于空佛身等重要观念中。佛教起源于印度，这个宗教思想有二系，大乘与小乘。本文的目的是要检讨现代学者的说法和就有关经论自身的说法来看大乘佛教思想的特色。首先，我们要对大乘佛教的兴起做一简单的交代。又本文所谓大乘佛教只在印度发展者而言。一、大乘佛教的兴起。大乘佛教是印度佛教内部的一个重要的宗教运动，对佛教的发展有极其深远的影响。但它在印度的兴起的历史并不明朗。现代学者多以为它的兴起大抵是在纪元前一世纪至纪元后一世纪，若追寻其渊源，则可更推前至佛灭后一世纪。P124，在那个时期，佛教分裂为18个或更多个学派，各有其特异的教理。其中的11个学派被视为保守的正统者。这正统即后来所谓小乘之意。其余的7个学派由大众部 Mosdika 领导，表现较开放的态度。这大众部便是大乘佛教的发端。在思想上，大众部一方面批评保守者的阿罗汉 Arhat 的狭隘的理想，一方面发挥空的义理，认为真正的佛陀是超现世的，历史的释迦牟尼不过是他的视线而已。他们又提出菩萨 Bodhisattva 的理想人格，认为菩萨的道路是人人可行的。一个学派的思想特色与其兴起的真正的原因自有不可分割的关系，但我们不能对大乘佛教兴起的真正原因有很多的知识。不过，康塞 Econs 以为有两点是可确定的。 其一是阿罗汉的理想已到了山穷水尽的阶段，其二是在家信众的压力。关于第一点，阿罗汉所表示的独善其身的出世的理想，在佛灭三四百年后已见失去其魅力，也越来越少僧人达到这个目标。代之而起的是菩萨的理想。关于第二点，人变得越来越重要，而与法 Dharma 齐平。出家僧众不再单独享有被尊崇、被重视的权利，而在家信众中也出现不少杰出的人物，经典中的维摩诘 Vimalakirti 即是一个显明的例子。佛教的宗教意义已不能再局限于僧人与僧院方面了。在家信众开始积极参与种种的宗教活动。一，随着宗教的发展，思想也渐趋成熟。由纪元前一世纪至纪元后三世纪，不少大乘经典先后出现。最先出现的是《般若经》（Prajnaparamita）， 跟着有《维摩经》（Vimalakirti）、《Nirdesha》、《法华经》（Sadharma）、《Purika》、《阿弥陀经》（Sukhvatthihastra）、《十的经》（Dvaitmika）、《等初期大乘经典，此中自以《般若经》为代表。此经最初由少量见字附加，至七世纪左右而成一大丛书。其空的思想一般认为是大乘佛教的基本教理。P 125。其后有南印度出身的龙树 Ankarjuna 在哲学方面发挥这空的思想。他这有中论 Matthayamakakrit 及回正论 Vagrahavivartan 批判部派小乘的六见，建立中道观，而名之为缘起，假名空。龙树以后续有大乘经典出现，如《涅槃经》（Mohari Nirvastra）、《圣蛮经》（Rimaldev Sihandastra）、《解生密经》（Sadi Nirmakana）、《楞伽经》（Lakvadra）。其中的《解生密经》的唯识说有弥勒 （Maitreya）、舞者 Asana、 世亲 Faisabhanu 等人发扬，其分别代表作为《大乘庄严经论》（Mahayana Stravaka）、《摄大乘论》（Mahayana Sagraha） 及《唯识三十颂》（Trayekvihaptinprasitha）。 其主旨是以实来解说世间现象。二，关于大乘名称的由来。大乘这个名称，按大乘自是与小乘对说而有其意义。大乘的相应梵语是 Mahayana， 是大的车程或行程之意。小乘的相应梵文为 Hayana， 是小的低等的车程或行程之意。说小乘显然有贬义之意，相应的说大乘有显扬之意。实际上大乘是那些后来的持教开放态度的佛教徒的字称，他们称那些原来的保守的佛教徒为小乘，后者从未自称为小乘。 他们也不喜欢被称为小臣，他们原来是属于上座部 Theravada 现在的佛教学者。不管是欧美的、日本的，亦是印度的，都以大小乘之名分别指那较开放的与较保守的派系，但这称呼是中性的，并无显扬或贬义的意味，也不表示要赞成大乘反对小乘之意。至于现在的上座部信徒，则仍不喜被称为小乘。实际上，大乘一名的渊源可上溯至原始佛教。汉译《阿含经》便在多处提到这个名字，如《长阿含经》P 126 God Nikya Way。佛为海船师，法桥渡河经，大乘道之余，一切渡天人。二杂阿含经 Samta Nikya Way。 阿难，我正法律城、天城、婆罗门城，大乘能调伏烦恼君者。三此外还有多处部录。在佛之世，佛教徒当然未一想到尔后大小乘佛教的分途发展。阿含经用大乘之名，大指指佛的教法，而含有尊崇之意。这大乘字不同于尔后大乘佛教的大乘，但亦非全部相通。大乘佛教自有其发展，但其基本教理并不远离佛的本意。附带一说，小乘一名亦见于阿含经中，如增益阿含经 Agatara Nikya Way。 如来有四不可思议事，非小圣所能知。四这样说小乘自有贬损之意。三现代学者论大乘佛教。以下我们检讨现代学者论大乘佛教思想的特色。首先看铃木大拙的说法。铃木给大乘佛教下了一个定义，为大乘佛教由一种进取的精神所激发，在不违离佛陀教法的内在的精神下，扩展了本来的领域。另外，他把其他的宗教的哲学的信仰吸收到自己方面来，因为这样可使不同性格和智能的人得到解救。五在与小乘的对比下，他认为大乘佛教较自由和富进取性，但在很多方面都有形而上学意味和充满思辨。六不过铃木并不大强调大小乘的相异处，他认为这种相异并不是值得相异，这种不同只在于两者的取向而已。大乘要开拓宗教的自觉，扩展知识的范限，小乘则要力求保全僧院的律则和传统。他认为两者都从同一的精神出发，走同一的道路。P 127-7铃木这样论大乘自然是对的，但显然太空泛，使人难以捉摸。不过他总给人一个印象，即是大乘有较宽的襟怀，要解救较多的人。这与他较后提出大乘是菩萨 Bodhisattva 的佛教一点很能相应。他说大乘是菩萨的佛教，而独觉 pratyekabuddha 和声闻 ravaka 则被大乘行者视为小乘之徒。八，说大乘佛教绝离不开他的主角，这即是菩萨。抗塞在这方面便叫铃木大拙为具体。他说大乘佛教的首要之点是，它是一种生活之道，伴之以一种非常清晰的观念。这即是灵性的完美 spiritual perfection， 和能使人达至这灵性的完美的步骤。九，他所说的正是菩萨。灵性的完美即是六种波罗蜜多 Pramit， 那些步骤即是十的 Vikmai， 这两者是菩萨实践的主要内容。在这两者之中，抗塞特别重视波罗蜜多。他说菩萨的极其重要的工作是要破除自我，自我是成佛的障碍，要破自我是很不容易的。他说菩萨为了达至这个目标，采取两面的做法，在行动方面自我牺牲和无私服务，在认识方面渗透自我不存在的真理。由此抗塞提出菩萨必备的两个条件，慈悲 compassion 与智慧 wisdom。 十，他说这两者的结合有赖于六波罗蜜多的实践。十一，抗塞的所论有近于铃木大拙之处，理由是他不如铃木般空泛，却具体的把大乘规定到菩萨方面来，而在菩萨方面他更把焦点置于波罗蜜多上。据般若经，波罗蜜多是菩萨的六面实践，所谓六波罗蜜多，这即是布施、Dhamma、持戒、力、忍辱、Nitti、精进、Vraya、禅定、Dhamma、智慧、Prajna。 前五者可归于慈悲，最后的智慧则特别指空之智慧，即观诸法无自性空的般若智，借此可渗透自我不存在的真理。这六波罗蜜多并不是并行的，而是以般若智统帅前五波罗蜜多。这点在小品般若经 Ashasrik Prajna Pramit 中说得很清楚。十二 ，P 一百二十八，就上所论，在慈悲与智慧之间，抗塞似乎较重智慧，但大乘佛教作为一种宗教，或菩萨之所以能成为宗教的理想人格，似应以慈悲为重。这慈悲的要点，可以不舍弃事。兼一意概括之，抗塞以菩萨来说大乘思想的特色，故甚具体切要，但是否全无问题，则仍有商榷之处。关于这点，下文继续讨论。以下我们看平川章论大乘佛教。平川章首先把菩萨拆分为几个项目，菩萨、观念、六波罗蜜多、实地，然后强调这几项都不是大乘所独有，在此之前已出现了，即是菩萨、观念已出现于原始佛教五部派佛教中，六波罗蜜多的教理已显现于《大士书》Mohvastu 与《大毗婆沙论》Abhidharma Mahavibhuta Sutra 中，儿时的思想的萌芽亦可在《 大士书中见到。十三，平川的意思四是单凭菩萨一点，不足以规定大乘思想的特色。在另一方面，平川特别强调般若经的空的思想。他以为般若经本着无所得的立场，使空的思想深刻化，而成为大乘佛教的基本立场。由空使人想到空智般若，他以为基于这空而来的空智是大乘佛教的一个特征。般若经本着空无所得的立场而说方便，以尽于社会的救度，在以社会为目的的运作中有自己的解脱在。这点与小乘佛教不同，后者只谋求个人的救度。他并强调菩萨的六波罗蜜多与十德的修行，若建基于这空的思想之上，便即改观，立场也变得不同。十四，四大乘佛教的空论的特色。平川的说法是不错的，空是佛教最重要的一个观念，大小乘对他的看法不尽相同。大乘的空论却有其特色，它的特色也应可表示大乘思想的特色。以下我们即以般若经为代表看大乘佛教的空论。 P129 笔者在拙文般若经的空义及其表现逻辑。15中曾表示般若经的空义是以无自性来规定它和现象世界的关系，是不偏向舍离，相当重视世间法，这是与小乘不同之处。关于不偏向舍离一点，其明显表示在于《心经》Dhyanastra 的名句“色即是空，空即是色”。这色空相即，实显示般若经要本着现象世界是无自性，因而是空这一基本认识与不离现象世界的基本态度，来显示现象与空之间的互相限制、相即不离的关系。这不偏向舍离一点，也极其显明地表示于小品般若经中所谓不坏假名而说实义。此中假名即指一般的世间法或现实世界。我们这里要说的是不偏向舍离，即是不舍世间，这是般若经以至大乘佛教的空论的特色。有关其他问题请参看上面所提拙文，此处从略。对于般若经的空论的这个特色，从华严宗的法藏世界看得很清楚。他抨斥小乘教即色非空，灭色方空的狭隘立场，而提出色即是空，非色灭空。即是说空并不妨碍世间法，空即在世间法处成立，不必要灭去世间法才有空。十六，不必要灭去世间法，即含不舍世间之意。十七，五，大乘佛教论佛身。由上面所论，我们似可建立初步的看法，以大乘思想的特色在不舍世间。这主要是显示于其空观中，菩萨的实践自然也有这个意思。 他的智慧，其对象即是这空观。他的慈悲，也以不舍世间为基础。一般所谓菩萨流祸润身，便是这不舍之意。小乘后期纵有菩萨思想，自不如大乘般成熟。至于铃木大拙所说大乘有较宽的襟怀，要解救较多的人，这些人总是在世间的，故铃木论大乘亦不离开不舍世间之意。不舍世间是一种精神方向、生活态度，这方向或态度亦显示于大乘佛教的其他重要观念中，如佛身、真如与如来藏。以下为省篇幅记指责佛身来论。 P130 关于佛身，通常是三身的说法，这即是佛基本上只是释迦牟尼，他是一个历史人物，又是最高真理的觉悟者，故他有物理之身，也有精神之身。另外，为了普度众生，他不时出现于世间，故又有示现之身。示现之身又可示现为佛陀，而成一个历史人物，故这示现之身又可与物理之身结合为一。在此之外，又有佛自受乐的身，因此而有三身。物理之身即色身，指在历史中出现的佛陀，这是大家都能了解的。法身则指那普遍的精神，在历史的佛陀中显示出来。阿含经已说到法身，如杂阿含经为如来之体身，法身性清净。十八增益阿含经为尊者阿难作是念，如来法身不败坏。十九又为肉身虽取灭度，法身存在。二十故出其佛教大只是二身、色身、法身的说法。自后大乘佛教兴起，乃有受用身及变化身的提出。受用身指佛享受佛法的乐趣时的身，也是专为对菩萨说法而示现的。变化身则是佛陀为了救度众生而示现出来的种种变化的身体。其最明显的莫如在历史中真正出现的释迦牟尼。由是便有三身之说，自性身 Svabhavika Kaya 即法身，受用身 Svabhavika Kaya 变化身 Namika Kaya。 我们要特别注意的是变化身，它的成立是由于佛陀为了救度众生，这众生自是世间的众生，这便透露不舍世间的含义。这种身相当于较早期提出的三身、法身、报身。应身中的应身，所谓应，是佛陀对世间的需求的回应，此中很有其积极的意义。唯识学派以变化身是成所作智所现，这亦显示它与世间的密切相连。因成所作智是成办世间种种度生事物的智慧。 P131 是世间的智慧。六大乘经论论大乘佛教。以下我们看大乘经论自身如何论大乘佛教。 这样看起码可以让我们知道大乘经论的作者如何自觉地理解他们自身的思想。这或许可以补本文开首说我们不能充分知道大乘佛教兴起的真正原因一点的不足。首先看《法华经》，该经基本上是通过与小乘做比较来论述大乘。该经为若有众生内有智性，从佛世尊闻法信受，因勤精进，欲速出三界，自求涅槃，是名声闻成。若有众生从佛世尊闻法信受，因勤精进，求自然慧，乐独善，即深知诸法因缘，是名辟支佛乘。若有众生从佛世尊闻法信受，勤修精进，求一切智，佛智、自然智、无师智、如来之见、力、摩所谓泯灭安乐无量众生，得一天人，度脱一切，是名大乘。二十一，此中论小乘的要点是欲速出三界，自求涅槃，即乐独善济。论大乘的要点则是泯灭安乐无量众生，利益天人，度脱一切。对比起来，小乘的舍离世间的精神或态度与大乘的不舍世间的精神或态度非常明显。以下看大智度论，该论基本上亦是通过与小乘做比较来论述大乘。该论为佛法皆是一种一位，所谓苦境解脱位。此解脱位有二种，一者但自为身，二者兼为一切众生。虽具求一解脱门，而有自利利人之意，是故有大小乘差别。二十二，据大智度论，大小乘都有同一的目标，这即是解脱，但两者的做法不同。小乘是自利，只为自身；大乘则是利人，兼为一切众生。自利是把自身与世间分割开来，这便是舍离；利人则是把自身与世间结合在一起，是利人即是自利，这便是不舍。P 132。另外，大智度论又以大慈悲心的有无来判分大乘与小乘。小乘无大慈悲心，大乘有大慈悲心。二十三，这大慈悲心是表现于利人的行为中的。大智度论更就智慧言说，小乘的智慧浅薄，不能深入诸法，故不说世间即是涅槃。大乘的智慧则深厚，能深入诸法，故说世间即是涅槃。二十四，这世间即是涅槃的说法与心经的色即是空的说法是同一思路，都是肯定现实的世界即此即是真理之意。世间即此即是涅槃，故不必舍世间以求涅槃。涅槃的理想即在世间中，不舍世间之意至为明显。以下看大乘庄严经论，论大乘佛教。该论为大乘佛教有七大义，缘、情、智、情、巧、果，是皆具足，依此七大义建立于大乘。二十五， 所谓大义，即不同于小乘的特别殊胜的义理。这七者是缘、行、智、情、巧、果、事。无者解释这七大义位。若具足七种大义，说为大乘。义者缘大，由无量修多罗等广大法位缘故。二者行大，由自利利他行皆具足故。三者智大，由人法二无我一时通达故。四者情大，由三大阿僧之劫无间修故。五者巧大，由不舍生死而不染故。六者果大，由智得利摩所谓不共法故。七者事大，由数数事现大菩提大涅槃故。二十六，此中我们要特别注意行代与巧大。行大是具足自利与利他行，巧大是不舍生死而不染，即是不舍生死烦恼，但亦不为其所染者。生死烦恼实是就世间而言，不舍生死烦恼其实是不舍世间，故行代与巧大都是不舍世间之意。七，不舍世间的特色。由上所论，我们可以说大乘思想的特色在于不舍世间这一精神方向或生活态度。这当然是与小乘思想相对比而言。我们不说这是大乘的本质，那是避免读者误解。大、小乘各有不同的本质之故。我们认为大、小乘在本质上是相同的。P 133，他们都从缘起性空这一基本认识出发，都求解脱。他们的分歧是在对世间的态度方面。这不舍世间的态度可以说贯通着一切大乘经论，而由以大乘经未然。上两提到的维摩经可以说是最显明的例子。它的名句如不断烦恼而入涅槃，二十七菩萨于生死而不舍，二十八但除其病而不除法，二十九说的都是这个态度。另外唯识宗的涅槃观也有表示这种态度之处。按成唯识论，论涅槃分为四种，本来自性清净涅槃，有余依涅槃，无余依涅槃，无住涅槃。三十成论解释罪后的无住处涅槃位，为其真如除所知障，大悲般若常所覆意，由思不住生死涅槃，利乐有情，穷未来际，用而常计，故名涅槃。三十一，此种涅槃具有积极进取的意义，利乐有情与用都表示不舍离世间之意。E.C.F.E. Cox, Mahayana Buddhism, in his 30 years of Buddhist studies. Oxford, Bruno Kasserer, 1967. Pages. 50年5月余。二大正一二下。大正指大正新修大藏经下同。三大正二二零零下，四大正二六四零上，五 D.T. Suzuki Outlines of Mahayana Buddhism, New York, Skulking Books, 1963 p 十六 event p 二七 event pages 四年五月八 event p 九九 econs Mahayana Buddhism p 五十三十 event pages 五十四六十二十一 event p 六十四十二小品般若经为五波罗蜜住般若波罗蜜中而得增长为般若波罗蜜所护故的向萨婆若般若波罗蜜为五波罗蜜作导大正八五四四中有为五波罗蜜离般若波罗蜜亦如盲人无道不能修道至萨婆若大正八五五零上十三平川章佛典解题释典序章载于中村元代表编辑佛典解题释典台北地平县出版社翻印1977年 P15 另外平川章在其另一书中亦曾述及杜特 Endot 的看法杜特大体上亦认为菩萨的思想在小乘佛教后期已有出现平川章者初期大乘佛教研究东京春秋社1968年 Pages 三年四月十四 Island 十五此文曾于华港佛学学报第八期发表十六参看桌文龙树与华严哲学内名一五一期十七说到大乘空论的特色有些学者提出小乘只说人空或人无我大乘则兼说人空与法空或人无我与法无我彼等颇有以大乘空论的特色在兼说人法二空之意杜特即持此说 CFN. Mahayana Buddhism Calcutta Firma KL Mukhopat HYA 1973 P82 按此种说法并不全地实际上法空之说并不限于大乘杂阿含经说到世间空大正二五六中这世间空实即法空同书又说到五蕴空大正二六九上这亦是法空之意关于法空之说不限于大乘一点大智度论作者亦早已指出为三藏处处说及法空大正二五二九五下同书并为小乘多事先说无常后说法空大正二五五四四上十八大正二一六八中十九大正二五五零上二十大正二七八七中二十一大正九一三中二十二大正二五七五六中二十三大正二五六一九下二十四大正二五一九七下一九八上二十五大正三一六五四下二十六 Island 二十七大正一四五三九下二十八大正一四五四四下二十九大正一四五四五上三十左伯定应教定 新岛成为实论，奈良法隆寺发行，1972年三版 ，pages 447-448。三十一 ，event p 448。越狱经的研究以瑜伽师的论有关部分为主。http://www.jix.edu/chapter-html/chbj-02。Click 等于 iwary.yjt.p4.wy9.u.e.u.29.e.w.q8.e.j.h.q2.november4.f2.bookjf 中华佛学学报第二期 ,P143-155, 民国77年台北中华佛学研究所http://www.trix.edu.tw Chang Hua Buddhist Journal No 02-1988 Taipei The Chang Hua Institute of Buddhist Studies ISSN 越狱经的研究以瑜伽师的论有关部分为主。释慧敏，日本东京大学印度哲学研究科研究生。提要：瑜伽师的论所述，当随越狱往师主家之段落，古来住世家并没有意识到是阿含部之越狱经的引文，因此不能做贴切的诠释。拙论从现存南北传的越狱经诸本对照研究中追究入他家的越狱之本意，应该是小心谨慎，舍离贪欲，惭愧谦虚。而别一杂阿含之越狱经却将善恶之事知盈缺越狱混同于中。瑜伽论记之注释有将涅盘经之越狱张冠李戴的可能。佛经中之所谓越狱有各式各样的种类，例如入他家善恶之事，如来常住，需认清真正的寓意，不能只从单一角度去解释譬喻之教义。一前言，在瑜伽师的论以下简称瑜伽论之声闻的出瑜伽处出离的仪中实之量以及正之而住二个论题处都提及当随越狱往师主家。二所谓越狱究竟是何意？窥基法师所撰之瑜伽师的论略纂云：越能清凉一人入师主家，身有清凉，亦于师主，亦如越也。三。此外，顿轮法师即撰之瑜伽论记亦说：神太窥基同云。越能清凉一人入师主家，身有清凉，亦于师主，亦如越也。经又更解，如涅盘经说如空中月。P 144。从初一日至十五日，渐渐增长。善知识者亦复如是，命诸学人渐远恶法，增长善法。四。可是相对瑜伽论之叙述应该是杂阿含经之越狱经 Kandropama Sutra 的结录，因此想讨论瑜伽论如何引用越狱经以了解越狱之真。 亦进一步比较《越狱经》南北传承与新旧传本之差异，并与《瑜伽论》之引文对照研究其异同。最后顺便讨论在《杂阿含》中被编排于《越狱经》后之《诗语经》。同样的，它亦在《瑜伽论》被引用于《越狱经》之后，可见两经之密切关系。二、越狱经之传译。五、A 汉译三本。一、杂阿含经第四十一卷 No 1136大正 2.299 下300上，刘宋求那跋陀罗于 AD 435-443年间译，以下简称杂阅。二、别译杂阿含经第六卷 No 111大正 2.414 上下，姚琴坚 AD 350-431译，译者失明，以下简称别阅。三、佛说越狱经大正 2.544 中545上宋师护 AD 980译，以下简称佛阅。B 南传相应部 Can Japan Moon 越狱经 S3P1982000日译南传相应部卷13P2902945以下简称佛阅。C 梵文断简 Can Dropen Ma 越狱经 AF Rudolf Homerno 于东土耳其斯坦Eastern Turkestan Nation 所发现之写本编号 149X 斜线石。越狱经可说是阿含部中少数梵巴汉同时现存的经典之一。但是 Purno 是写本不完全，仅有三分之一，因此仅就瑜伽论所引用部分仪式库拉氏所校刊之深文帝范文本六来讨论。 P145 三越狱经之主旨。主旨世尊以月心学比丘明眼人临深渊等譬喻，教导比丘们应该以何心态入施主家应功说法。七、瑜伽论当随越狱往施主家 Kendro Puma SCA Kuni Yukusen Kermayan 杂月当如月辟住而入他家，别月如等皆当勤修善行渐渐增长，如月出生往返人间，比丘一耳如月出生渐渐增长善行日新。佛月如是所见皎月圆满行于虚空清净无碍入白衣舍。八 S 月 Can Japan Pick Have Cool Nayupusen Kamasa 斜线斜线左开示圆括号比丘们应如月一般的入他家。世尊以月作譬喻之教导，可能是在夜晚为比丘说法时，以现况的月作为画端。这种情形在其他的经律中亦常出现，例如《中阿含》卷48《牛角梭罗林经》记述尊者舍利子 Riputra 问阿难曰：“此牛角梭罗林甚可爱乐，夜有明月，诸梭罗树皆敷妙香，犹若天花。贤者阿难，何等比丘启发牛角梭罗林？参考巴利原典，此牛角梭罗林为何等比丘美丽的观赏？”九。 即是以现场之美丽的梭罗林之月夜作为画端而问答比丘应具备何种功德的经典。究竟越狱所要表达的心态是什么？杂月 S 月中没有月之特征的说明，别月则有说明，如月出生，渐渐增长，善行日新。佛月却认为是皎月圆满，行于虚空，清净无碍。至于瑜伽论注释方面，如前言所介绍的，神态与窥基两位法师或许没有意识到是杂阿含的引文而解释为月能清凉一人。入施主家，身有清凉，亦于施主，亦如月也。虽然顿轮法师另外提出，如《涅盘经》说，如空中月，从初一日至十五日，渐渐增长，增长善法之补充解释，但仍然有商榷的余地。要想解明如是等差异，有必要先从《月狱经》的全文结构分析开始讨论。 P 146 4. 月狱经之全文结构。全经可大分为三段。一、序分。 A 冒号月狱， B 冒号月狱之辅助说明与譬喻。二、应以何种心态接受施主供养。三、如何区别清净说法与不清净说法。与瑜伽论引文有相关的是一、序分 A、B 以及二。因此以下仅就这三点来讨论。五、越狱。从文化史来看，越可以说是人类相当熟悉且亲切的自然现象之一。月的清凉、盈缺、清净等等种种特征，亦多彩多姿地反映在神话、诗歌、美术、音乐等不同文化层面。同样的，在大小乘经论中，以月作譬喻的说法亦是有各式各样的含义。今先就差异最显著的别月之盈缺喻，如月出生，渐渐增长，善行日新，与其他佛典的盈缺月喻用力做比较。从其他阿含不知用力来看，世尊的盈缺月喻几乎可说是善知识 Kalama Mitra 和恶知识之定型譬喻。云何善男子，善知识，其譬如月。佛告婆罗门，譬如明月净分，初一至十五，光明色泽，日夜增明，乃至月满一切圆净。杂阿含卷四十。云何当观善知识犹如月耶？世尊答曰：梵志犹如月出生，少壮明净，日日增长。梵志或十月十五日，其殿圆满。中阿含卷三十六十一，犹如月出生时，随所经过日夜，光明渐增，稍稍成满，便于十五日具足成满。若善知识，经历日夜，增益阿含十二。相反的，恶知识却如月之黑分，十五以后明镜渐减，乃至月末。 P 147。 此类用月之盈缺来比喻善知识与恶知识的用力，在大乘经典亦出现，譬如华严经卷七十七十三。因此别月中如月出生，渐渐增长，善行日新之越狱 的盈缺解释，或许是将其他经之善知识、恶知识之隐缺越狱，混同于入他家之越狱。至于《瑜伽论记》所说如《涅盘经》说如空中越增长善法之解释，《涅盘经》的确是有越狱品十四，但它是以人们认为越有出没隐缺，但事实上越是不出不没、不增不灭之譬喻来说明如来常住的思想。因此《瑜伽论记》中不仅是将善知识之隐缺越狱误解，入他家之越狱有可能亦误引《涅盘经》中如来常住之越狱品。究竟入他家之越狱应该如何理解呢？这需要研究他的辅助说明与譬喻。六、越狱之辅助说明与譬喻。瑜伽论，荡涤身心，安住惭愧，远离骄傲。Vipassana Kyan Vipassana Siddham Hrna Pragopa。杂乐如心学，惭愧软下，摄心脸行，而入他家如明目视夫，临身登峰，摄心脸行，难速前进。别乐时有比丘，初始受戒，渐修惭愧，善持威仪，往返人间，柔和恭顺，部位狠力，能治身心，如明眼人，必生空景及山峻岸。佛曰：而诸别除，不破威仪，常如出蜡者，具足惭愧，若身若心，曾无散乱，如其法仪，入白衣舍，清净无染，亦复如是。诸别除，又如明眼人，或入大水深广之中，或涉江河险恶之处，或履山岩高下之所，以明眼故，而悉能见离诸一句。S 月 ，Apakusimakayam Apakusasidam Vikamavakosu Apagavik 斜线斜线 ，Sifpikhav Puri Sojardavnam Vilokiya。Pravadivisamong Vinatvigagam Vapakasimakayan Apakasasidam 斜线 Livemivakopikhav Kanjabem Kuniyukasim Kamatha Apakasimakayan Apakasasidam Nikonavakalaisu Apagavik 斜线斜线左开示圆括号收身摄心，于他家时常应如新出家者般的谨慎小心。 P 148。 比丘们譬如有临古井或山崖或深渊，收身摄心，常应如新出家者般的谨慎小心。以瑜伽论为主比较上列诸文，相同的部分有二类。一、瑜伽论，荡涤身心 ，Vipassana Kyan Vipassana Siddham。杂乐，摄心脸行。别乐，能治身心。佛乐，若身若心，曾无散乱。S 乐 ，Apakasima Kyan Apakasana Siddham， 收身摄心。二、瑜伽论。安住惭愧，远离骄傲 ，Hrna Pragopa。杂乐，惭愧软下。别乐，渐修惭愧，柔和恭顺，部位狠力。佛乐，具足惭愧。S 乐 ，Apagavik， 谨慎小心。至于各本《越狱经》所共有之新出家者 Navak 十五山崖的二个辅助譬喻，在《瑜伽论》中被省略。 但是要表达荡涤身心惭愧谨慎之越欲入他家的主，只是可以共通确定的。因此如上节所说，别越中将善恶之事之隐缺越狱混同于入他家越狱的论证将更有力。十六，另外佛越中进一步将越譬喻清净无碍将，如出蜡者譬喻清净无染将，明眼人临深渊譬喻离诸切具，个别对应成三种解释。这可以看出宋朝师护 AD980 所译之佛说越狱经已经有相当的变化了。在各本越狱经续分之末，世尊都是举出迦叶喀斯帕比丘作为榜样，称赞他虽是长老，能经常如越狱新出家者人临深渊般的荡涤身心惭愧谨慎入他家。在这以后，有位比丘尼恶骂迦叶尊者的事件发生，迦叶尊者即引用世尊曾说，当如月辟柱常如心学，其为摩诃迦叶比丘时期来证明自己的德行。此外在帕利注释文献 Avakatha 18中亦可发现越狱与大迦叶尊者的关系甚为密切。 P149 7. 应以何种心态接受施主供养？瑜伽论，不自高举，不轻蔑他，如自获得所有力养，心生喜悦，如是于他所得力养，心亦喜悦。And mod curse apar pens lus finom anasitam syn. Sumen ivan parasite pic anasitam syn sumen。杂乐于他的力，他做功德。心若在己，不生吉想，亦不自举，亦不下人。别月见他力养，心生欢喜；见他施比，亦不愤恨。于修福者，贤皆随喜。又不自赞己有德行，诸所言说，恒为一切。见与比丘同至他家，终不讥毁。于自他所心无高下。佛曰：虽受力养，但欲为彼作诸福事，随自所得分量而受。复善作意，于自不高，于他不下。S 曰 ：The sakano anatmano hoti sumano 斜线 ivan parisamu anatmano hoti sumano 斜线，如自获得，越亦欢喜；如是于他所得，亦越亦欢喜。若以瑜伽论为主，以为表示不自高举，不轻蔑他，以 B 表示如自获得所有力养，心生喜悦，如是于他所得力养，心亦喜悦。分析各本《越狱经》中 A 与 B 之存否，以实亦表示结果如下。 A B 杂月实实，别月实实，增加许多解释。佛曰：十一 ，S 曰：一十。虽然 S 曰缺少 A， 但主要部分 B 仍是相同。因此，瑜伽论之引文是符合于杂乐、别乐与 S 乐的。至于佛曰缺少 B 而代之以，但欲为彼作诸福是随自得分量而受，这并不像彼是讨论， 当施主供养其他同行比丘时，亦应心生喜悦，如同自己获得般喜悦，同行比丘皆知自他一体的修养。P150。佛曰，却把重点放在说明亦应以是让施主种福田、做功德的心情，随自得分量，随缘而受供养。就这一点来说 ，S 月中亦有类似的观念。Lavan Buell B H K N Park Karong to Ponti 斜线斜线左开是圆括号想的供养者的供养，想做功德者做功德。但是杂月、别月与瑜伽论都没提到。诸本之差异值得注意。此外，各本越狱经都有世尊以守门虚空而不着不复不染于空的譬喻来说明，入他家接受供养时应保持不着不复不染之心态。八师语经，于现存的杂阿含、别译杂阿含以及南传相应不知越狱经之后，紧接着是施语经，南传称为 Kulapogan 十九。同样的，在瑜伽论中引用越狱经后，紧接着亦引用施语经。又应如是自持其心往施主家，其有出家往诣他所，一要望他施，非不会施；二要望他敬，非不恭敬；三要多非少；四要妙非粗；五要当速疾而非迟缓。二十经文中一五之编号是笔者附加。Event Sitas CA Panakul Ni Upasen Kermayam 斜线 Tad Kuta Atalabian Prav Rahitana Parakul Suryat 一 Dada to Mi Pair NNA Dada to 斜线二 Sat Krishya Mi Sat Krishya 三 Pravtan and Stokam 四 Prantan and Mulam 五 T Faritan and Gatvam 斜线。所谓施语经之经题是根据别译杂阿含之摄诵二十一而称呼的，南传则称为 Kulapogan 入施主家经。世尊所要教导的主旨是与越狱经异曲同工，教戒比丘们入施主家应供时不应该有的五种心态，并且仍然是举出大家业尊者为榜样，要求比丘们向他学习。但是各本所叙述及顺序稍有不同，不同点以表示瑜伽论之顺序对照于后。杂阿含一，彼当施我，莫令不施一二。顿失非见失 P 一百五十一三多失非少失三四甚失非漏失四五速失非缓失五别意杂阿含若有所失一一当速与我勿令迟晚五二至心师我非不至诚二三愿使多的物令寡少三四会我精细物的粗舍四南传相应部一 then to yafa me and I don't soon 一要师与我物令不师二 but you can me for me then to and no can 三要施我多勿令寡少。三 ，Pantifa me then to and looks 四。 药师我妙物令粗陋。四 skiva mi dentu and denta 五药素师我物令迟缓。五 sakakuniva mi dentu and as they come t 二药功尽失我物令不尽。其中杂阿含之二顿失非见失与诸本比较，或许原是药功尽失我物令不尽之意思，或者是其他原因而造成差异。但是杂阿含之顺序与瑜伽论相合。九结语。在佛典中讨论到比丘应如何入施主家应供时，代表性的教戒除越狱经、施语经外，还有法句经中之如风采华的譬喻，它经常被引用于阿含二十二律部二十三等，而被称为过去七佛教界之第四尊佛居留孙 Kokhtachan 的如来之教界记。譬如风采华不坏色与香 P152， 但取其位去比丘入俱然二十四，将以上三部教戒合在一起来叙述的，譬如《毗尼母经》之入白衣舍二十五之第一部分，即符合《越狱经》。比丘若入白衣舍时，如月光欲摄心；若入聚落行时，应卑躬惭愧而行摄心之法。譬如人足蹈高山悬岩绝眼方寸之处，念念生怖，更无余念佛问比丘如等入聚。若如月徐行步，有惭愧步。越狱在此说明为摄心徐行，而摄心之法，如人临深渊般念念生怖，更无余念。从瑜伽论之荡涤身心的梵语 Vivekasayakai Vivekasayasiddham 或者 S 月之巴利语 Apakasivakayam Apakasvasiddham 来检讨 Vivekasayakayavadikars 是舍离 draw or tear away 书外 alienate 二十六隐遁娴静 solitary secluded 二十七之意，而巴利语 apakasa 亦有谨慎的远离 modestly drawing back keeping aloof 二十八等意义。而所谓舍离是舍离贪欲等杂念，而毗尼母经所说念念生怖更无余念与此符合，这应该才是瑜伽论之荡涤身心或诸本越狱经所说摄心敛行能治身心之意义。因此关于世尊以越狱教戒比丘们应该小心谨慎，如临深渊般舍离贪欲与骄傲的行为，荡涤身心，摄心敛行，而入施主家之越狱经，太基二位法师之越能清。梁义仁的解释，别越之盈缺越狱，或佛越二十九之清净无碍等着眼点语，越狱本意是有差异的。附记本稿承蒙大正大学综合佛教研究所声闻的研究会及川真介老师指导教师江岛惠教博士斋藤明助教等给予许多宝贵意见，在此记之以致万分谢意。P 155 A study on the simile of moon with special reference to the Yorkra by my and related sources. Sheikh Wei Ming. Since ancient times, the commentators of the Yorkra by my have not been conscious of the fact that the passage stating how one should proceed towards the donor as home in compliance with the simile of the moon refers to the Agama version of this simile, and as a consequence, their interpretations missed the point made. In the present paper it was discovered, through a comparative study of all extant versions of the simile in both the southern and northern traditions, that in the context of entering another one as home, the simile originally should have meant very cautious, having abandoned greed, and with shame and care. The version in the variant Agama translation, however, confused this with the idea of good and bad friends expressed through the simile of the waxing and waning moon, and the interpretation given in the Yu Qi and Lun Ji seems to have the simile wrongly identified as that in the Nirvana Sutra. As Buddhist sutras contain many different similes of the moon, it is essential to grasp their real meaning in each individual case. One must not explain every instance from just one point of view.
以声闻的分为四阶段来论，即出瑜伽处乃至第四瑜伽处。出瑜伽处在分为种性地、去入的、出离第三阶段。二大正三十一正四百零九上、四百一十五下、六百零七下有提到《越狱经》。三大正四十三点一一一中。四大正四十二点四三四下，而作指如月也。五参照《佛书解说大辞典》卷二 P 七十八，卷七 PP 六十一年六月二。山田龙城梵语佛典朱文宪 P 三十九。六 Keshukula Rupaka Vikmai of Karya Sangha Tibetan Sanskrit Work Series Vol.Patna 1973大正大学综合佛教研究所之声闻的研究会，从1981年起在旧式库拉之刊本重新比对写本，并将残缺部分以藏译本补足，并与日译科判之后陆续发表于大正大学综合佛教研究所年报 No. 3 4 6 7 8 9。桌文所用的范文部分即是采用该研究会之校订本 No. 8 PP 72 74。七比丘接受施主供养后，经常随后为信徒说法，这种场合常出现于经律中。世尊即是针对这种状况而说《越狱经》。八大正二点五四四中，而作入日一舍。九大正一点七二七上。十大正二点二五下，十一大正一点六六零中，十二大正二点五八四下，五百八十五上，十三大正十点四二二上， 十四大正十二点六五七上六百五十八中八百九十上八百九十一中。十五后而 no 是将 nava 物意为新月。十六别月中渐修惭愧，仍然有受到如月出生渐渐增长隐缺越狱之影响。十七大正二点三零二中下四百一十七中。十八增之不知注释 Manorot have plan IP 一百八十三 of 乃川真介意大家业法华文化研究 no 一万三千一百九十八七点三 p 二十一上。Ben Moffat of a Thakusa 二 p 一百六十九 pts 版。十九大正二点三零零上中四百一十四下四百一十五上 s 十六点四 pp 二零零二零二日益难传相应部卷十三 pp 两百九十四两百九十七。二十大正三十点四零九中四百一十五下。二十一大正二点四一九下。二十二大正二点七八七上。二十三五分界本大正二十二 p 两百上。四分界本大正二十二 p 一千零二十二中一千零三十上等。二十四四分界本大正二十二 p 一千零二十二中一千零三十上。二十五大正二十四点八三六上下。二十六 M. Munir, Williams, Sanskrit, English Dictionary, p. 一千零三十二。二十七 F. Edgerton, Buddhist Hybrid Sanskrit Dictionary, p. 五百一十五。二十八 A Critical Pali Dictionary, Fall E. Copenhagen, 一千九百二十四。P 两百六十一，二十九，佛乐之明眼人灵深渊的离珠一句的说明，显然与原来的意味有相当的距离了。中华佛学学报第零八期 ，P 四五五四八一，民国八十四年，台北中华佛学研究所。http 冒号双斜线 www.trips.edu.tw Chung Hua Buddhist Journal No 08-1995 Taipei The Chung Hua Institute of Buddhist Studies ISSN 1017-7132April, Buddhist Meditation System and its Early Modifications by Gautama the Bodhisattva, I. By Swadev Mukherjee. Visiting Professor Chung Hua Institute of Buddhist Studies. P455. Summary.The present paper is the first part of the article dealing with the modifications wrought by Gautama the Bodhisattva in the Renwa system of meditation, which had gained prominence even before the rise of the Buddhism. The problem has been dealt with reference to the Sirupadmas.Created by the Paroma, Dihakama, Nidnathans long before the advent of the Buddha. In this paper, an attempt has been made to form a clear idea about the Sirupadmas. The formulas of the sigmas contain informations not only about the mental states in different stages of meditation but also about the process leading to such states. The interpretations of these formulas given in the Buddhist commentaries are often much later date and are more reflection of the current Buddhist thoughts than that of the Paramā, Dhammā, Nyāna. It is, however, imperative that to understand truly the import of the sigmas we must understand the philosophy of the Paramā, Dhammā, Nyāna of which these sigmas originally formed a part. An attempt has, therefore, been made to reconstruct this philosophy. It has been shown that the sole purpose for which the Paramā, Dhammā, Nyāna's led a religious event was not to gain enlightenment but to experience an agreeable feeling like tisukha, sukha, etc. Nyāna merely stood for an unhindered enjoyment of an agreeable feeling. The meditative technique, the modes of formulation of the sigma states are but the products of this philosophy. And it is in the light of this philosophy that we have tried to understand the import of the formulas, comprehend the true meaning of the technical terms like apekha, sukha, vitakha, vikra, etc. and to reconstruct the meditative technique employed by the Paramā, Dhamma, p. 456. The present paper thus prepares the ground for the proper understanding of the extent and nature of the modifications made by Gautama the Bodhisattva in the Sramana system of meditation. This contribution of the Bodhisattva will be discussed in the second part of the article. P. 457. Introduction. It is well known that the Buddhists in its process of growth incorporated and modified many non-Buddhist ideas and practices. This process seems to have started with Gautama still faring on his journey towards enlightenment. The ideas modified by Gautama the Bodhisattva remained part and parcel of the way later preached by the Buddha. This process can be fruitfully studied with reference to what is generally known as the system of formal meditations, The Brahmajala Sutta mentions the four yanas as a part of the spiritual practice of the religious sect of the Paramā, Dhamma, Nyāna. It appears that this was the earliest of the religious sects to be associated with the four yanas. Again, the Buddhist suttas speak of a system of meditation where the four yamas are followed by the four rupya, sampadis, san. Those eight stages of meditation are jointly called ahat, sampadis in the nikyas. It appears that the followers of the rupya meditation also practiced the four yamas but did not accept these stages as final attainments, as the nirvana in this very world,
and proceeded further up to the stage of neither perception nor not perception. We will later see that both these groups of meditators follow the same technique of negating the undesirable mental factor only. For attaining a higher state of meditation, this view may be objected on the ground that the account in which the four yamas precede the four rupyas sampadas is a creation of the Buddhists and does not reflect the original tradition of the rupya meditators. In support of this, P458 opinion, we may point out that even a cursory glance at the four yamas recorded in the Buddhist suttas in a gradually ascending order will immediately show that the higher states of meditation invariably reject a mental factor of the immediately preceding lower yamas. The formulations of two such states of meditation even use identical expression for the mental factor valued in the lower state but rejected in the higher state of meditation. On the contrary, the first rupa sampatti, which immediately follows the fourth rupanya, does not reject any of the mental factors attending the fourth rupanya. The first rupa meditation does not, therefore, appear to have been necessarily preceded by the fourth rupanya. This objection could be negotiated if we pay attention to the technical terms characterizing the fourth rupanya, viz. Adhakame suksana, purified sati, sati, parasati. None of these penetrates could be given up by any meditator who is striving to advance further than the fourth yama. Purified sati constitutes the very essence of the mental state of an advanced meditator. Its presence in the first rupa meditation is to be taken for granted even though it is not mentioned by name in the Panic formula. Moreover, the feeling, Phaedon, Adhakame Suksa, being a neutral feeling, is not an impediment to spiritual growth, and so need not be given up. Still, we may even insist that this neutral feeling must be preserved, for the absence of this feeling would automatically give rise to some other feeling which would agitate the mind. The point to be taken note of in this respect is that none of the mental factors in the fourth yama is dispensable or should be given up. On the basis of the above discussion, we may conclude that the mere absence of rejection of a characteristic of the fourth yama in the description of the first rupa meditation cannot be construed as an evidence against the tradition that the first rupa meditation immediately follows the fourth yama. Moreover, this P459 tradition is confirmed by the statement that the first rupa meditation is attained by transcending the sphere of qi, the system of four yamas practiced by the Buddhists as well as by two influential groups of pre
Buddhist Renwas may be regarded as one of the important contributions made by the Renwas to the religious culture of India. As already noted, the Paroma, the Hakama, Nagnathans appears to be the earliest religious group to practice the four yugas, and thus they should be credited with the original formulation of the four Yogic states. It is, therefore, obvious that to understand the transformation the system of four Rupa meditations underwent at the hand of Gautama the Bodhisattva, we must first be clear about the exact implication of its Yogic formulas and other aspects of the Paroma, the Hakama, Nagnatha philosophy. Our study of the Paroma, the Hakama, Nagnatha philosophy, however, is bound to suffer greatly from the scarcity of materials, as no literature of this group has come down to us. Our only source consists of the fragments of informations preserved in the Buddhist scripture about this group. The available translations of such materials are generally based on later Buddhist commentaries by Buddhaghosa and others, whereas the Paroma, the Nagnathans flourished long before the Buddha. Thus there is a gap of more than 1,000 years between the later Buddhist commentaries and the original formulation of the non-Buddhist materials preserved in the Buddhist scriptures. Moreover, much of such materials became a part of Buddhism even during the lifetime of the Buddha. Consequently, the Buddhists in course of time came to interpret the four yugas and other materials in the light of their own philosophy. This situation warns us against blind acceptance of the explanations given in the later Buddhist texts. The philosophy and the four Yogic formulations are but a reflection of their Yogic experience and the method of meditation followed by them. All these aspects form an integrated whole. A proper understanding of any part of this system of meditation is, therefore, dependent on the understanding of other parts. P460. For the sake of convenience, we may start with a translation of the relevant materials as given in the Brahmacla Sutta of the Dhamma Nikaya. The deviations from the current translations will be justified later in course of our discussion. Translation. A preparatory stage. The relevant passages of the Brahmacharya Sutta giving a short sketch of the philosophy and the religious practices of the Paroma, the Hakama, Nagnathans may be translated as follows. Because there are some Sammas and Brahmas, advocates of the Supreme Nagna in the visible world, who declare in five ways the Supreme Nagna for the existing beings. On what authoritative tradition, on what basis do these honorable Sammas and Brahmas declare the Supreme through objects in the visible world for an existing being. Here some monk and Brahma speak thus and hold such a false view, that he, sir, as the soul that which is supplied with the five objects of desire, is in complete possession of them, enjoys himself, sir, the soul thus has attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. 八 Thus do some proclaim the supreme nirvana in the visible world for an existing being. B. Final stage. To him someone else says, sir, there is indeed this atom of which you speak. I do not say that this P. 461 does not exist, but this atom thus has not attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. Why? Sir, the desirable objects, kamma, are impermanent, painful, and naturally subject to change, as they become transformed grief, lamentation, pain, melancholy and despair, sukha, parideva, dukkha, domanasa, apis, arise. Since this at having separated itself from desirable objects and unwholesome mental states, attains the first jnana by starring which is born of separation, fifth kajan, characterized by rapturous happiness, tisuksan, and accompanied by thoughts of inquiry and judgmental decision, sevataksan sevakran, jyo, to that extent it has attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. Thus do some declare the supreme nirvana in the visible world of an existing being. To him someone else says, sir, there is indeed this of which you speak. I do not say that this does not exist, but the it has not thus attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. Why? Since in this case, the mind is involved with vitaka and vikra, it is called gross or wicked. Since the due to coming down of the vitaka and vikra, vitaka, vikrana, vipassan, attends and abides in the second jnana, which is characterized by internal clarity, a state of mind directed towards one object, shi, absence of vitaka and vikra, born of concentration, said, hygiene of rapturous happiness, tisuksan, so that it has attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. Thus do some declare the supreme nirvana in the visible world. To him. Why? P. 462. Indeed the it has not thus attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. Since in that case, the mental state is merged in joy, tgaten, and is a state of agitation of mind, citisoabil, vitaten, shi'i, so this is called gross. Since this is due to its detachment, verb, P. 463. From rapture, T is equanimous, apekhiko, mindful, subtle, and understanding, sampijano, and experiences happiness, sukha. Whom, i.e. the Aryans call equanimous,
mindful and dwelling in happiness, dwells having attained the third, the third, has attained the supreme nirvana in the visible world. Thus do some declare the supreme nirvana in the visible world. See, the fourth, to him. Why? Since in that case sukha, happiness, means the enjoyment through attention, bhoga, 12, of mind, due to this it is called gross, arupa. Since, sir, due to the abandoning, pain, of happiness, due to the abandoning of pain, dukkha, due to the previous disappearance of gladness and sadness, so manasa, domatas namathagam, tisa attends and abides in the force of neither pain nor happiness. Adhakam asuksan and purity of mindfulness due to indifference, apek, sati, Prasadhan, 13, this has attained the supreme nirvana in this world. Thus do some declare the supreme nirvana in the visible world of an existing being. Philosophy. The core of the Paroma, Dehabhama, nirvana philosophy mainly deals with the three types of feelings dukkha, sukha and adhakamasuksan. It is, therefore, necessary to know clearly what these concepts stand for before we commence our study of the philosophy of this religious group. These three feelings together with TRO mental reactions to physical. P464. Sensations, they are all associated with the body and thus differ from somanasa and domanasa, which are purely mental in origin. The connection of T with the body is clear from a statement in the Gaunika I-73. Gladness, Pmojaja, arises within him, thus gladdened rapture, T, arises in him, and when he is rapturous his body becomes tranquil. Tranquility in turn leads to sukha, physical happiness, on the basis of which mind becomes concentrated. Buddhaghosa's description of the five types of ti, 14, also supports this view. According to Hinkadik, ti, minor rapture, is first to appear and can cause the hairs of the body to stand. Kamikti, momentary rapture, is like lighting, but cannot be sustained for long. Okhantikti, showering rapture, runs through the body and waves, producing a thrill but not a lasting impact. Avagyapati, uplifting rapture, causes liberation, while therapy, or pervading rapture, suffuses the whole body. Again, Buddhaghosa states that he annihilates dukkha, which suggests the physical association of dukkha, bodily pain. The Paroma, Dehabhama, Nignathans also believe in the physical association of T and the three feelings, for they also differentiated between the three types of feelings and somanasa, domanasa. Moreover, T is inseparably connected with sukha, and sukha is explicitly stated to be experienced through the kaya,
15. In the description of the third nun, the Paroma, the Hotama, the Nathans were divided into four groups. Each of these groups identified the experience of one of the four. Thus, with the attainment of Nibbana in this physical world, the fourth nun represents the highest peak of agreeable experience that can be attained by this religious sect. P465. It can be reasonably assumed that like the different religious groups of that time, the Paroma, the Hotama, Nibbanathans also strove for the cessation of dukkha, the painful feeling. The end of dukkha may either merely mean the absence of dukkha, or it may indicate the presence of an agreeable feeling which prevents the rise of dukkha in mind, and thus marks the cessation of any further experience of the painful feeling. As we have already pointed out, dukkha, being a feeling, theta, is like the other two feelings, invariably connected with the body and the notion of I, 16, so long and meditator possesses a body, he is bound to experience one feeling or the other, and in accordance with his spiritual development, will either appreciate it as the final goal or be dissatisfied with any of the feelings other than the feeling of dukkha, may sukha, neither pain nor happiness. Such a feeling is regarded as the highest, the best, Paroma Nibbana in the world. The use of the attribute Paroma shows that the feeling recognized as Nibbana can only stand for one type of agreeable feeling, and not refer to agreeable feelings of different types. The eradication of the false reality of I is neither attempted nor aspired for, as the sole aim of spiritual life is the personal enjoyment of an agreeable feeling. Each of the four Yahanic states contains two types of mental factors. The first type, e.g. sati, sampijana, etc., represents the knower aspect of mind, while the second type deals with that aspect which is to be known. The second type includes tisukha, sukha, and adukha may sukha, which not only negate dukkha, the painful feeling, but also constitute positive, agreeable elements to be felt. Thus of all the factors in the Yahanic states, only these three types of feelings can be equated with the supreme Nibbana in the physical world. As the three feelings are co-existent with the body, one can only try not to be overwhelmed by a feeling which is either painful or unsatisfactory to him. One can even so exert oneself that these undesirable feelings do not arise in the mind. This situation finds its reflection in the use of such terms as virga, detachment, panna, giving up, and apek, indifference, 17. All these terms can be used. P466. Only with reference to something which has not been destroyed, which may manifest itself under suitable circumstances. One can only give up what one possesses. One cannot be indifferent to or detached from what is non-existent. All these terms refer to feelings associated with the body and possessed by the body. It is, however, possible to have full control over the moods of happiness and depression, somanasa and domanasa, and to cause their disappearance, for the factors responsible for their origin are exclusively mental. According to the Milinda Penha, since the ground and condition for the arising of the feelings of bodily pain are not yet removed, therefore he may yet experience the feeling of bodily pain. Since, however, the ground and condition for the arising of the feeling of mental pain are removed, therefore he can no longer experience the feeling of mental pain. 18. This state of things is indicated by the use of the term thagama with reference to somanasa and domanasa. 19. They believe that the agreeable feelings associated with the body could be made stable through meditation. This conclusion is based on the observation that they criticize karma and the agreeable feelings in different ways. Karma or five objects of desire are criticized on the ground that they are subject to change and destruction, and thus cause grief, depression, etc. Here the criticism is based on the impermanency of the outside objects of desire. But the internal, agreeable feelings connected with the body are not criticized on the ground of impermanency. These are criticized because these are gross. 20. The meditator P467 is attached to the enjoyment of agreeable feelings, and he wants to have more intense and higher type of enjoyment through subtler feelings. But he is not worried about the possibility of the absence of a feeling which is agreeable to him. This shows that he is confident that the feeling is stable and not subject to involuntary changes. A feeling is considered gross if it adversely affects the quality of enjoyment as well as the power of the mind to enjoy. For grosser the feeling is, the greater is the agitation it causes, and thus diminishes the concentration and the intensity of awareness of an object. The feeling of a dukkha suksam in the fourth na is, therefore, most suitable for the enjoyment. Because the nature of the agreeable feeling is so neutral and subtle that it does not affect at all the mindfulness and awareness of the meditator. The grossness of feeling, as it will be shown later, is due to the presence of vikara and vitaka in the first note, due to its speeding abhivaitatan in the second na, and due to the plaga of mind in the third na. 21. The parama, dhabhamma, Nagnathan's belief in the notion of a and were actually striving for the enjoyment of ego-centric pleasure. So, their mindfulness and awareness were not perfect, and they failed to understand the true nature of Vedana. It is also for the same reason that they fail to appreciate the role of mindfulness and awareness as a means to realize the truth. To them, these mental faculties were for perfecting the quality of experience of Vedanta. Moreover, this led to imperfect development of morality, as is evident from their concept of akusala, dhamma. From the above discussion, it follows that the paroma, dehatama, nignatha is a kind of sakaya, dahi, according to which the attest Veda. This religious sect was not concerned with the eternity or destructibility of it. Their nirvana was the attainment by the adhavan, agreeable feeling which is extremely subtle, neutral, unchangeable, i.e. not subject to involuntary change, and absolutely free from dukkha. Every human being possessed a number of souls, and each of these souls enjoyed a particular type of agreeable feeling, the most subtle of such feelings, i.e. Adhakame Suksan, was worthy of being. P. 468. Accepted by all the groups of the Parma, Dehatama, Nagnathans as the supreme Nibbana in the visible world. Comments on the Panic Formula. A. On the progression from lower to higher in the preparatory stage, an individual tries to be free from suffering, dukkha, through the enjoyment of five types of Kamma, Pankhavathulai. When he has complete mastery over the Kammas with which he is abundantly provided, Samalpitan, he thinks that he has attained Nibbana, the very opposite of Dukkha. Now, what is meant by Kan in the present context? Kamma may mean either desire or object of desire. In the present context, Kamma should be understood in the sense of object of desire, for it is stated that when Kamma undergoes change or destruction, one suffers grief, lamentation, etc. Here Kamma cannot mean desire, for destruction of desire is always considered desirable as a spiritual attainment, and an ascete would surely not grieve for it. So Kamma means five types of desirable sense objects. Objects of mind or dhammas are not included in the category of Kamma. The Buddhists also used the term Kamma in the sense of sense objects in Samsuttas, 22. It is to be noted that the agreeable mental state arising out of the enjoyment of five types of external objects is not called Sukha. It is not given any particular name, and is simply equated with the supreme Nibbana, as it keeps in abeyance the disagreeable mental states. Sukha is a technical term which stands for a particular type of feeling of happiness to be experienced only in meditation of the rupa sphere. According to the information preserved in the Brahmacharya Sutta, the meditator understands the disadvantages of karma because of its impermanency and the resultant unwholesome mental states of grief, etc. Consequently, he separates himself from the desirable sense objects and unwholesome mental states. Can he vivaksa akusa hidana he vivaksa? This sequence of happenings in the life of a meditator is instructive. It is obvious that the meditator is separation from P469. Karma and akusala, dhamma is the result of his judgmental deliberations showing the disadvantages of karma. Such deliberations, as we shall see later, are comparable to vitaka referred to in the Vitaka Sutta. These deliberations are based on the direct experience of the meditator. Regarding the impermanency of sense objects, and they create aversion for the sense objects and thus enable the meditator to get separated from the, as already noted in the preparatory stage. The meditator experiences karmas and the resultant painful mental states of grief, etc. This is immediately followed by the statement that the meditator enters the first yuga, the description of which includes such expressions as Sevataksan and Sevakram and the information about the giving up of the karmas and the akusala dhammas. On the basis of the account given in the preparatory stage, we can conclude that karma means the five desirable sense objects and the akusala dhammas refer to the unwholesome mental states, e.g. grief, lamentation, etc., one experiences due to the involuntary separation from or destruction of the karmas. The vikra and the vitaka, on the other hand, refer to judgmental deliberations concerning only the experience of the impermanency of the karmas and the resultant painful mental states. The vitaka and vikra, as we shall see later, come to an end before the attainment of the second yuga. But it does not mean that the meditator has got rid of all types of deliberations. There are judgmental deliberations between any two states of meditation. The judgmental deliberations prefacing the attainments of the second, third and fourth yugas are, however, not concerned with karma, and so no longer called vitaka and vikra. 24. Both the vitaka and vikra, and the akusala, dhammas fall within the range of experience of an ordinary person. These mental states are called not good akusala, for they represent a situation which is just the opposite of mukna, the ideal agreeable feeling. The term akusala is not moral in its implication, it merely indicates the undesirableness of a mental state that experientially runs counter to dhamma. In order to critically understand the implications of the dhamma formulas, it is necessary to pay attention to the following principles relevant to a dhammic state. P 470. 1. Mind in concentration can know only one object at a time. 2. The description of four dhammas stands for four different types of mental states and include not only the characteristics connected with the act of knowing but allows characteristics indicating the object to be known. For example, the terms subtle, sampijano, etc. refer to the knowing aspect of mind, while tisukha, sukha, etc. to the objects to be known. 3. The characteristics of dhammic experience state are simultaneously present. It is obvious that there can be only one knowable element in the dhammic state that the meditator can be aware of during the series of moments that constitutes the duration of dhamma. The other elements in the dhammic state belong to the aspect of knowing. We may start with the discussion of the terms of vitaka and vikra in the expression sevataka sevakra, the practice or non-practice of which is related to the attainments of the first dhamma and the second dhamma respectively. Face up and hood, 25, takes vitaka and vikra as two types of thoughts and defines vitaka as a mental conversation, manojalpa, of inquiry, pre-ego, which is characterized by either volition, citta, or discernment, prajna, and constitutes the grossness of mind. Vikra, according to him, is a mental conversation of judgment. Pratyapadhaka, characterized by either volition or discernment. This view of face-up and who is similar to that of the ancient masters. 26. Thus, vitaka and vikra can appear only successively and not simultaneously. Face up and hood, therefore, pointed out that the first dhamma has only four parts and not five parts. Face. Piti, sukha, samvi plus vitaka or vikra, 27. From the point of view of the Paroma, Dhamma, Nignathan's Sandhi is not of primary importance, so it is not explicitly mentioned in the Dhamma formula. And we cannot simply drop either the Vitaka or the Vikra, both these. P 471. Terms are well grounded in the tradition as a part of the dhammic formula, which not only originated with the Paroma, Dhamma, Nignathans, but also was followed by the followers of the Arupyasamputis, the Buddha, and the later Buddhists. Moreover, if we accept the view of the Vaikikas, it would follow that the first dhamma is attainable with the help of the gross vitaka only, and the comparatively subtle Vikra is not indispensable. We have, therefore, to accept both the Vitaka and Vikra as being associated with the first known, and at the same time we have to admit that they, being successive, cannot be simultaneously present in the Yahanic state. In other words, they cannot be regarded as the features of the first known experienced by the meditator in concentration at any given moment. So it follows that the expression Sevataksam Sevakram has to be interpreted in a way that only shows their relatedness to the first known without making them an integral part of the known experience. This is possible if we take them as belonging to process leading to the known, but not to the Yahanic state. This suggestion is strengthened if we pay attention to the drift of the discussion on the Paroma, Dihadhamma, Nignathans as recorded in the Brahmacharya. Here we see that the Vitaka and Vikra give rise to the separation, Vivka, from Kama and Akusala Dhammas, and this separation in its turn gives rise to first the Vivkajan Patanmajnam. This shows that the Vitaka and Vikra become non-functional before the attainment of the first Nukle. Are not integrated into the Yahanic experience, but only are related to the first Nukle through the intermediary state. P472. Of Vivka, this aspect is more explicit in the Vipapatakasutta. The immediate cause of Tisukha in the first known is Vivka from Kama and Akusala Dhamma. Concentration of mind cannot be the cause, FOT. The first known is accompanied by Vitaka. Vikra, the preparatory stage, is also dominated by deliberations, and not by sending. Therefore this Inna is called born of Vivka, Vivkajan. But how are we to understand the meaning of Tisukha? The term Tisukha is a Bahavari compound qualifying the expression Patanma. Now, but what is the relationship between its component parts T and Sukha? Should T be interpreted as a Veda meaning T and Sukha? Or should it be taken to mean rapturous happiness, a Karmapuraya compound? We should take note of the fact that the religious strivings of the Paroma, Dihadhamma, Nignathans were solely directed towards the realization of an agreeable feeling which to them was the same as the Supreme Nigna. Every formula of Mus is a record of important spiritual achievements, and the Yahanic formulas are so arranged as to show the gradual progression from grosser feeling to subtler feeling. Seen from this point of view, it is reasonable to conclude that the term Tisukha should represent only one kind of feeling, the Ti, which is not a feeling, is not an important spiritual achievement. It is therefore, Better to take tea sukha as a karmadraya compound which expresses clearly the quality of sukha to be felt. The dvanda compound would be a generalized statement about sukha and would not throw any light on the precise quality of sukha. Moreover, only one knowable can be known at a time. Tisukha as a dvanda compound would mean the simultaneous presence of two knowables, implying thereby the ability of mind in concentration to know two objects at one and the same time. But this is not possible. Hence Tisukha should be taken as a karmadraya compound meaning rapturous happiness. We have seen in our discussion of Sevataka and Sevaka that the Dhamma formula not only describes the next state actually experienced but also the process leading to it. Thus it is possible to interpret the compound Tisukha as T and Sukha if we could have related T to the process leading to the first Na. As a part of the process, the awarenesses of T and Sukha can occur successively. But this interpretation excludes the possibility of mentioning any. P 473. Agreeable feeling as the ultimate goal of the spiritual life. Hence this interpretation is not acceptable. So we have to interpret the compound Tisukha as indicating a type of sukha, the quality of which has been influenced adversely by pit. The expression tivarat will mean the removal the influence of the over sukha. Some meditators felt dissatisfied with the experience in first na. Due to the presence of vitaka, Vikra this na is considered to be orika, gross. So the meditator calms down the vitaka, Vikra, vitaka, Vikrana 5%. Consequently his mind becomes more concentrated. And he attends the second na which is characterized by the absence of vitaka, vikra, internal clarity, ajhana sampasthana, and a state of mind directed towards one object, katasodhikodhipa, then. All these characteristics reveal the nature of the mental state born of concentration, sampajan. The sampi is incidental, and the main factor in this na for the meditator is what is to be felt, viz. Tisukha, or rapturous happiness. Due to the influence of samadhi, the second na is more calm compared to the first na, so the tisukha causes comparatively less agitation, and should be regarded as less gross than the tisukha of the first na. The type of sukha one experiences in the second na is still mixed with the tea, we have seen, agitates the body strongly, and consequently disturbs the mental calmness. It is because of this tea that the mental state in the second meditation becomes merged in tea and consequently suffers from agitation, This state is therefore called auric, gross. So the meditator now gives up the rapture and enters the third nirvana by staring. In the formula of the third nirvana as given in the Brahma place sutta and other places, the term apekhako referring to the ut who has attained the third nirvana has been mentioned twice. Apekhako means that the ut has attained apek. Now why has the term apekhako been mentioned twice? Does it mean that apekhako refers to the possession of two different mental states? Or can apek mean feeling here? In the first place we read that the ut due to detachment from rapture, t, dwells in different, mindful and discerning, tca verb. Apekhako ca viharati sato sampajno. Detachment from T is the cause of apek, and apek is. P 474. Surely linked to T. Apek merely implies one who is indifferent to T. It is not a feeling. It is a mental action by which no attention is paid. Tuti. Apek here appears to be similar to a manasikrat, a term used by the Rupathins in their Nga formula, 28. The Nga formula mentions for the second time the term apekhako while quoting the statement made by the noble ones in confirmation of the mental state in the third Nga referred to above. Yan ten ari sikanti apekhako sadin sukavir. In both the places apekhako means the same thing. This conclusion is supported by the use of almost identical language in both the cases. Moreover, as the feeling of sukha is experienced by the in this apek cannot be taken as a feeling here. The sukha is free from the influence of the and therefore, more developed and subtle in the third Nga. Sukha is regarded as the supreme Nga in the visible world by the meditator. But the meditator does not remain satisfied for long with this experience in the third Nga. His mental concentration, mindfulness, and power of discernment have always become quite developed. These mental faculties at first enables him to enjoy the feeling of sukha more intensely, but gradually leads him to the discernment of grossness in sukha. Sukha is no longer the supreme nigna for him. What is the reason for his perception of grossness in sukha? It is connected with the pragya of mind, the mental enjoyment. The word pragya is derived from the root bhaje, which can mean to bend or to enjoy. Thus apagha implies some activity of mind in the form of paying attention in order to enjoy the feeling of sukha. 29. This disturbs the mental calmness and adversely affects the enjoyment of an agreeable feeling. Hence the grossness of sukha. The first part of the fourth Henek formula appears to summarize the spiritual. P 475. Gains achieved so far. The meditator had been able to remain free from the influence of dukkha, otherwise he would not be able to enjoy tisukha in the first na. Again, it is by giving up the pure feeling of sukha he was able to experience the more subtle feeling of adhyakme sukha in the fourth na. The purely mental feelings of somanasa and domanasa have disappeared even before pagapa. The giving up of sukha, and the mind need not react to these mental feelings anymore. So apekha of apek, satic prasati in the fourth. Inner should not be related to somanasa and domanasa, but the feeling of sukha being associated with body cannot be totally destroyed. Though the meditator does not identify himself anymore with sukha and dukkha, and can disassociate himself from them, so the ability of mind to know a thing perfectly is no longer affected by the experience of dukkha and sukha. The phrase apek, satic prasati should thus mean either purity of mindfulness due to equanimity or equanimity and purity of mindfulness. Equanimity is here with reference to dukkha and sukha, and is not associated with somanasa and domanasa. I have accepted the first interpretation, as it tallies with the explanation given in the Vipava. Sanshi, apek in this case can in no way be understood as being the only feeling to be experienced in the fourth na is the dhakkhame sukha, for the sake of which the comparatively grosser feeling of sukha of the third na had to be given up. This is the most subtle bodily feeling that a meditator can experience. It does not hamper at all the perfect execution of the activity of mindfulness. The concept of adhyakme sukha as the supreme nirvana was not rejected by any group of the Paroma, Dihakama, Nignathas. We are now able to critically comment on the contents of a Inna formula. The Inna formula appears to be mnemonic statement not only about mental elements determining the quality of the mind, that expiring and mental element as an object of experience, but also about the meditative technique and process leading to the attainment of aima. P476. B. Meditative technique. The Paroma, Dihakama, Nignathans followed an identical method of meditation before and after the attainment of the first na. In both the cases we read about the rejection of undesirable mental elements, igusalakama, tisukha, etc., but not of the willful and direct cultivation of the desirable element. This will be clear when we analyze the spiritual exertions of the followers of this sect. They suffer from sukha, parideva, dukkha, domanasa, apyas when they lose the desirable objects which they were so long enjoying.
This entire series of undesirable mental elements can be, for the sake of convenience, put under the category of the feeling of dukkha. In order to get rid of the feeling of dukkha from which they were suffering and to attain the first no, they only put forth efforts to get separated from the desirable objects and the resultant feeling of dukkha, but do not at all strive for the direct cultivation of the agreeable feeling of tisukha to be enjoyed in the first no. Due to the conscious rejection of kamma and akusalabhamma, the feeling of tisukha automatically arises in the mind. It appears that the expulsion of the undesirable feeling and the appearance of the desirable feeling happen almost simultaneously, for so long the body exists, one must experience one or the other feeling. But how does one get rid of the undesirable mental elements of kamma and akusalabhammas? In the Brahmacharya-sutta account of the Paroma Deha Nignavans, we read that an undesirable mental factor gets eliminated when the meditator becomes aware of the disadvantages associated with this factor and mentally expresses the. This account seems to be incomplete. Such a first criticism will create aversion for the said mental element. But the cultivation of the aversion only will not be able to negate the undesirable element. Intense cultivation of aversion for an element would cause the element to be constantly present in the tufts of the meditator. Consequently, the undesirable element will not recede into the background. On the contrary, it would get strengthened and adversely affect the entire mental state. What is necessary is not to pay any attention to it. When the adverse criticism has weakened the attachment for the undesirable element and generated aversion for it, criticism of it should be stopped, so that thoughts are no longer directed towards it. This process, though, P477, not expressly stated, must have been followed by the Brahma, Deha, Nignavans, as it is evident from their success in eliminating the harmful element. Our conclusion gains support when we take note of the fact that Renwa Gotama is a Bodhisattva and the other Renwa sects of the Rupavins and the Akhidavans are explicitly stated to have followed the same method of not paying attention to the undesirable element. As is evident from the use of the term manasik, etc. In the formulas of the Rupya Sampatis, Sanshi, we may conclude that the same method of eliminating the undesirable element by first creating aversion leading to the destruction of attachment for it, and then paying no attention to it was also followed in getting rid of the tisukha in the higher stages of meditation.
Partial confirmation of our interpretation of the four yunas can be found in the writing of the early Buddhist masters. That the confirmation is partial is to be expected. For our interpretation of the panic formulas is based on the philosophy of the Paroma, Diha, Dhamma, Nignathas. The original formulators of these formulas, Sagabhadra states that the Vitaka and Vikra are two types of thought and cannot occur at the same time. The Sotrantika teachers also point out that as the Vitaka and Vikra belong to the same species, they must arise successively and not simultaneously. They further state that Vedan and Sanjay belonging to different species can exist simultaneously. It is to be noted that Parthi has not been mentioned in this connection. 32. The non-mention of Parthi might show that the Sotrantikas did not accept Parthi as an independent characteristic of the experienced. This is in conformity with the philosophy of the Paroma, Diha, Dhamma, Nignathas. P 478. That an agreeable Vedana is the ultimate goal of the spiritual life. In this connection, we may note the statement of Faisal and Hudat therefore. Himas are dominated by Vedan, Vedan, Prabhupadni, Hindi. By rejecting the different lower types of feelings, and by mentioning Madhyakame Suksan as the highest type of feeling that has been attained. The fourth Nigna again emphasizes the Vedana to be the supreme Nigna in this world. Moreover, some confirmation of our interpretation of the non-Buddhist Rama thoughts, especially regarding the meditative techniques, will be found in the fifth Vitaka Sutta, which we will discuss next. The spiritual journey of a Paroma, Dihapama, Nignathan in quest of an ideal happiness starting from the ordinary plane of sensual enjoyment of outside objects to the attainment of the fourth Yuna may be described as follows. An ordinary person experiences utmost happiness while fully enjoying an abundant supply of desirable objects, kama. But his happiness gives place to the feeling of pain when the objects undergo change and destruction. So he deliberates and comes to the decision, Vitaka and Vikra, that these objects are impermanent and ultimately lead to painful mental states, akusalakama, of grief, lamentation, etc. Thus the meditator frees himself from the attraction of these desirable objects and stops paying any further attention to them. Consequently, he gets separated from desirable objects and their painful effects, viz. The unwholesome mental states of grief, etc. Akusalakama, and attains the first Yuna characterized by rapturous happiness, Tisuka, born of separation, Vivka, Sanshisan, it is obvious that at this moment he is no longer aware of Vitaka and Vikra. When he emerges from the first na, he again becomes aware of Vitaka and Vikra and understands that they act as hindrances to the development of mental concentration and the proper enjoyment of the sukha. So it is Vitaka and Vikra that make the first na gross orica. This judgmental deliberation, which is no longer termed vitaka, vikra, creates P479 aversion for vitaka and vikra, takes his mind away from them, and calms down the vitaka and vikra. Consequently, his concentration develops and he attains the second na of the sukha of a subtler type born of concentration, sampajanti sukha dutivahana, which is to him the highest nigna attainable in this world. In his case, the development of sampi is incidental, and it finds mention in the formula only because it gives rise to a subtler type of tisuka. Arising from the second na, he perceives the grossness of the mental state due to the existence of the which agitates the mind. So he again practices judgmental deliberations, the contents of which deal with the grossness of the second na due to the existence of the, as in the case of judgmental deliberation regarding vitaka, vikra, here also the existence of deliberations is not explicitly acknowledged in the formula, but the role it plays can be inferred from the phrase T-verb, which draws our attention to the meditative process leading to the detachment from T. Consequently, in the third na, he experiences pure sukha undisturbed by the influence of the. In this state, sukha stands for nigna. Emerging from the third na, the meditator, however, notices the grossness. P480. Of mind due to the influence of sukha on mind, which bends towards and intensely enjoys the feeling of sukha. So sukha is also given up by following the same method of first generating aversion for sukha through deliberations and then withdrawing attention from it. The contents of judgmental deliberations in this case comprise the grossness of na due to the adverse effects of sukha. It is to be noted that the undesirable mental elements are without exception discarded in a state of non-absorption in between the two meditative states. For example, the vitaka and vikra are given up in between the first na and the second na, in between the second na and the third na, and sukha in between the third na and the fourth na. 关键词, iparoma, dihavhama, nipman, erti, sukha, 3.4, bonus, 4, apek, 5, renwang, meditation. P481 论四禅，乔达摩菩萨如何改定此一佛教前已有的法门？上木刻记，中华佛学研究所专任客座教授。
提要：佛教创立之前，印度的沙门早已用了修行法门。乔达摩菩萨如何改定其中至上现法涅槃说所提出的四色禅论，乃是本文探讨的主题。此所刊上篇，旨在清楚地说明何谓四色禅。固定描述四禅的文字中，不仅谈到不同境界的心所，且更论及如何达到禅的境界。佛典给这些文字的诠释年代都相当晚，而且反映当时的佛教思想，并不是代表至上现法涅槃说的见解。不过要真正了解四禅的定义，则必须首先明了传出四禅论的至上现法涅槃说，其思想究竟为何。因此本文尝试此方面的拟构，指出至上现法涅槃说修行的唯一目的，不在觉悟，而在经历喜乐等愉快的感受。涅槃所指的只是自在的享受快乐，提出四禅的修持法也只不过是这种思想的结果。因此本文是就其思想了解。固定描述四禅的文字和舍乐取四等名相的真正意义，并其拟构至上现法涅槃说的修行法门。如此本篇为下篇的主题，乔达摩菩萨如何改定沙门的法门而打基础。
一个 Vipapatakasata Mahimanika Vol IP 114FF 8非川 CK 2 PTS 1979。Bears testimony to the fact of Gautama S. practicing and modifying the system of four Padmas, which appears to have been originally developed by the pre-Buddhist Rama sect of the Parama, Dihadhamma, Nignathas, Dinghamika, Vol. I pages.三十六、三十八，三 C Ebit pages， 三十四、三十五 pages， 一百八十三 FF Mahayana Nikaya Vol I pages， 三十三、四百一十、四百五十四、五十五 Dhamma Sangha PTS。ED E. Muller 19 pages 55 FF etc 4 C pages 476 477 of the present article also not known 31 5 C page 463 of the present article6. Also see base of Anhumanopuvikra, Dharmopuvikra, Abhidharma, Kobya, ED. P. Pradhan, Padna, 1967, pages 146-49, in there. Relation to the Rupi Idol, H. Guna, Ratana, the path of serenity and insight.Motilal Banarsidass, New Delhi, 1985, p. 119. 7. Note the following expression in the first rupee of meditation, Ayamatsavasopasanam Samatiksan Pekasanam Mathlakan.That is a non emanasic mental case of titanium case and insightan pagal, Dinghamika, IP34.
八耶佛阿耨摩叭伽伊堪摩诃伊萨玛毗佛萨玛伽佛帕瑞毗提阿毗巴达阿耨摩婆罗摩帝哈婆摩那那毗佛诃提帝尼迦阿 P 三十六九 K N 毗婆 N C 嘎佛帕瑞那玛哈 T 三佛帕瑞那玛 S B H B U P P J D S O K A Pari Deva Daka Doma Nasa Apis Yato Ayan Adam Viva Si Eva Ken He Viva Ksa Akusala Hamahi Pamba Jnam Yukis Anma Javi Harati Dini Kyavo I Pages 36-37十 Ekodi of Ekodi by Po was first explained by S. Levi as Ekodi, W. Geiger, A. Pali Grammar, PTS 1994-38-3. The Nibbana of the Arthur Guinness Kia Stra supports this explanation, C. N. H. Santoni, et.Arthur Guinness Kia Sutra and its commentary Nibbana Padma 1971 P. 182. The relevant passage runs as follows: A case abdomen of Kirgati Ekestasiti Ekoti Ekudar Vipfa Ekot Vipfa Sikasa EkativeAlan Benoti Artha. The word EKA, one, single, means not anything else. T signifies movement, the act of going. One movement, Nkoti, means the movement. Skoti is unidirectional, ek. The state of unidirectional movement is ekat vipfa. The implication, artha, of one movement is one object of attention, lambanga. So sitaso ekodipapa means a state of mind directed towards one single object.The ekodibite of the third na develops into perfect mindfulness of the fourth na, as a woman points out, the vocabite mind while speaking of nine grades of mental concentration makes it clear that sending marks the highest state of mental concentration and is immediately preceded by a cut by cut from the point of view of mental concentration. A cut by cut is less developed than sending kamalash lorn as mishra, et aspects of Buddhist Sanskrit, central.Institute of Higher Tibetan Studies, 1993, P478. It may be noted here that both the Dhamma Sangha, Edward Muller, PTS, 1978, P21, and the Abhidharma, Koshavi of Visabhanhun, Ed.P. Prada, KPJS World Research Institute, Padma, 1967, P54, equates sending with CITTSCR-Eckert. 11. The expression abhivaitatam should mean a state of agitation. It is an abstract noun made out of the causative past participle.Abhilavita of the verbal root fell with the prefix ud. The following rules should be taken into consideration in understanding the term e. Frequently e is shortened to I before double consonants. Geiger, P.
Pali grammar 15.12 Voicing of P2V is common in Pali Geiger. Ibid. 38.5 So Abhilpita seems to be the original form of Abhilpita. 3. DV becomes BB through VV by progressive assimilation. 12. CP 474 of the present article for the discussion of the term Hoga, also known that face up and hood. Ibid P54 explains the act of paying attention as enjoyment of mind, manas grace a tasa hoga. 13, see pages 474-475 of the present article. 14, Hemaplogunaratana, Ibid. Pages 61-62, Fista Time Magad et Henry Clark Warren. Revised by Gunn Amanda Cosenby, Harvard University Press, 1950, p. 117. 15. Kaya means both body and the mental states in Buddhist scriptures. Perhaps both these meanings are implied in the present context. The Brahma, Dehagama, Nidnathans most probably used the expression Kayana in order to show the association of Sukha with body. 16, CP 463 of the present article, Gaunika, Vol. 2, P 67, PTS, London 1982, Shangwa F.O. Su Su Pao, No 6, July 1993, P 416, 17, 17, Gaunika, Fall I, P 37, also see pages 460, 463 of the present article. 18, CP 463 of the present article, Gaunika, I, P 37. 19, see pages. 460-463 of the present article, also note the following statements in the text. K and Hypoenixa, or Yadi Matatha Vitakana. Fikarita itana ata orakin, or Yadi Matatha Titus Sitiso Abil, Vitata itana ata orakin, or Yadi Matatha Suksa Mighty I Sitiso. Dago itana ata orakin, Gaunika, Vo. I pages 36. 37, 20, see pages 478-480 of the present article, see note no 19. 21, Fikama Seisata, Mahuhaima Nikya, 2, pages 42-43. 22, Mahuhaima Nikya, Vol. I, pages 114ff 23, see pages 458 of the present article, Gaunika, I, P 36 24, such mental deliberations are called Hisita, higher thoughts 25, face up and put in the Prakarabdha states, Vicharka Katama Xiexian Puri Eko Mano Haupas Sitan Prakshvi Xiexian Y states Yodri Kat Xiexian Xiexian Vikra. P.
Katama 斜线 Pray Job Kakomano Hopus Sitan Prajdia 斜线 The Sitsuskma 斜线斜线 Abhidur Mokovsian Louis DLA Bonga Kusa English Translation Bob E by Leo and Pruden California 1968 Pages 339四十 ，Note No， 171，二十六 ，The ancient masters say what is vitarka and mental conversation, manojalpa of inquiry, prerika, which has for its support volition, centre.Or the speculative consciousness depending on whether it does or does not contain deduction, abhidha. This is the grosser state of mind. What is vikra? And mental conversation of appreciation, of judgment, pariabhaka.Which has for its support volition a coerding. 2. This theory vitarka and vikra constitute two almost identical psychological complexes. They differ in that the first includes inquiry and the second judgment. Leo and Pruden, Ibid P 339, Note No.171 27 Abhidur Mokosubsyan P. Pradhan et Pages 60-61 Under the Sutra Vitarka Prathodaya Sukhmate 28 For reference See Note NOS 3 29 CF Monoskara is the modificationHagat of mind, in other words, to bend or to apply the mind towards an object. Manaskara is explained as Manasakara or Monakarati Varjati, C. Leo and Pruden, Ibid. P. 190. 30. Hagat, Rangoon, Burma.Buddhist Sama Samadhi, 1961, P 271, H Gunaratana, Ibid. P 99. 31, The non-Buddhist Ramasats were following a method of comprehending the demerits of the object of attraction in order to get rid of the attachment for it.And paying no attention to it anymore. None of these sects have, however, explicitly mentioned both these steps of the meditative process. While the Paroma, Dhyanama, Nidnathans give details only about the deliberations regarding the demerits of the sect.Object, others are explicit about the next step is withdrawal of attention from the object no longer desired, note such expressions as amnesic, somatics and again in the meditation formulas of the rupya, samapattis. 32.For the discussion in this para, see note no. 170, p. 339, of the English translation of the Abhidur Mokobya, fol. I also see the reference given in the note no. 27 of the present article.33. The accounts given about the meditative techniques followed by the non-Buddhist Rama sects make it clear that any agreeable mental
element automatically arises when one eliminates the disagreeable mental element. This method was successfully followed by these sects in order to get rid of any disagreeable vedam or sa. But such accounts run counter to the law of pratyasamutpada, which teaches that existing becoming to existence. The becoming of B is dependent on the prior existence of A. With the disappearance of A, B will also cease to exist. The non-existence of anything, actual or optional, cannot be the determining cause for the becoming of something. For example, the creation of a type of tisuka has been made to be dependent on the disappearance of kama and akusalabhamas, while a more subtle type of tisuka is generated by the coming down of vitaka and vikra. Again, the arising of pure sukha and the feeling of Adhakama Suksam are dependent on the detachment from T and the giving up of Sukha respectively. It is obvious that the formulas of the four Brahmas were created by those who had no idea of the law of Pratyasamutpada. http 冒号双斜线 www.jigs.edu.tw 斜线 chapter 底线 html 斜线 chbj 斜线08附录清新语录慧律法师者http 冒号双斜线 www.zaki.com 斜线 Buddhism 斜线 HLFY 2.html 学到虚是铁汉，着手心头变判，直取无上菩提，一切是非莫管。不识佛道，训示名字，如狗逐快。根深则叶茂，性明则道成。学道犹如守进城，昼防六贼夜兴兴，将军主帅能行令，不动干戈治太平。http 冒号双斜线 www.zaki.com 斜线 Buddhism 斜线 HLFY1.html